When I first met Quick, he was a little young boy at Red Shield Boys Club.
You know, when he was growing up as a little boy on commodity cheese.
He was the baddest kid in the neighborhood. He always had an old bike he would try to fix up. And instead of him asking mother to go buy him parts or something, he would always go take parts from other neighborhood kids.
He was just like the little brothers off in the hood. He was into everything. We didn't have the different things like you would find off in South Coast.
I didn't like staying all night with him because he always was wet in the bed. You know, back then we had to sleep in the same bed because there wasn't enough room for one of the single beds. But he said weak kidneys, but it wasn't weak kidneys. It's just that he drank too much Kool-Aid at night.
He had the ability to play like any sports that he wanted to. At the time, I didn't know he was involved with boxing.
I come to practice every day, and Quick like, wow, man, I love your boxing gloves. I love your boxing shoes.
Mom bought him for Christmas. He bought him some gloves. He used them boxing gloves on all the kids. I mean, he would whoop his sisters. Mother had to take the boxing gloves away from him.
So every day I come home from boxing practice, he ain't never practicing on his two jab right hand. So I would draw something else different on the wall, show him how to uppercut, hook. He took practice on that.
Quick Tillerson's first trainer was Ed Duncan. He started working with Quick and saw something in him when Quick was 15 years old.
He started Tillers and Keith Reed and everybody out, Warrior. That's the reason that they doing what they doing today through Coach Duncan.
And he was training over at the Chamberlain Recreation Center. I was training boys over at my house. There wasn't any boxing in town, and so Ed Duncan was over there training the boys over there, and I had about half a dozen boys, and he had James, and so we would take our boys together and go to some of the towns like Keene, Oklahoma City, and different places around as Tulsa's boxing team.
Quick was laughing because we had all our boxing gear. What boxing gear we had was in like a Safeway bag.
And everybody said, Ali, his name is just James Tillerson. I said, hey, y'all forget. Man, he's one of the quickest heavyweights I ever seen. I said, we ought to name him just James Quick Tillerson.
Our boxing tournaments, you know, were like six-day tournaments. And you had to fight. You know, if you lost the first night, you was out of the tournament to the next tournament.
But he was pretty well dedicated to the sport of boxing. So that helped him get, you know, where he was in the profession.
Had his one meager suitcase, and he puts his suitcase down and looks up at the Sears Tower and says, I finally made it. I'm finally here. I'm thinking big now. And he looks down and his suitcase is gone. And he was young and optimistic and enthusiastic. And the whole world was at his feet. And he was coming from an impoverished background. You know, he didn't even have much money to get to Chicago to go pro. And he was just latching on to whoever would take him and believe in him.
So Tillerson introduced me to Jimmy Colentez, who was one of his main managers. Tillerson and Colentez bonded. I think he wanted to call Jimmy Colentez his father, because they was just that close. And Jimmy Colentez took care of Tillerson. Anything Tillerson wanted, needed, cars, clothes, money, Tillerson had it from Colentez. But Tillerson was in the major newspapers in Chicago, all the TV stations covered him. Everywhere Tillerson went, cameras clicking, because the man brought Chicago alive with the boxing audience. We bonded with Ernie Terrell, because Ernie Terrell was one of the big promoters in Chicago. If the fight was in Chicago with Tillerson, Ernie Terrell, the legendary Ernie Terrell, was promoting. Tillerson came to Chicago at the right time, but he needed something in the boxing arena to draw. And Tillerson made Chicago big.
Here's Quick. I mean, he's a young guy, and he makes it to the pros.
James told me when he was going to Chicago, of course I didn't believe him. He said, I'm gonna make it to the top. When I make it to the top, I'm gonna call you, Ryan Roy. He tell you, come out there. I'm gonna make it. I say, okay, yeah. He shocked everybody, he shocked the world. I can remember reading in the Boxing Digest and the Ring Magazine about him when he was on the ride. So proud, I was showing everybody, this is my friend, James Quick Tillis. I get a call one day. I say, hello, and he said, Ronnie Warrior. And I said, who is this? He said, it's Quick Tillis. And so I thought somebody playing. I said, who is this calling me? No, this is James Quick Tillis, I'm in Chicago. He said, I got some backers and stuff. I've been telling them all about you.
Before the fight was confirmed, Tillis was out in Miami, Florida, somewhere out there with Angelo Dundee. And Tillis called me. Tillis said, cuz, what should I do? I said, what you mean, Tillis? Should I take the fight or should I wait and see who will win between Jerry Cooney and Mike Weaver? They said they guaranteed me the championship fight, but who would the winner might be?
Let him go ahead and fight Cooney, get that $1 million that they offered him, and then come back and fight both of them and come out even better on both ends. But you know, when you want to be the heavyweight champion of the world, then you know right then you anxious to do what you know you can do. And that's the reason Tillis took that road.
But I think Tillis was up under a lot of pressure from his backers, wanted him to fight Weaver right then.
The same guy that ran around the neighborhood, the same guy watched at the YMCA, here he is fighting for the world championship. It had to be the greatest experience for me as a fan.
15 round at the Rosemont Horizon. People came from Tulsa, Oklahoma, about 11 or 12 cars.
We had ringside seats, and we were just proud of our brother.
I was here in Oklahoma, right down there in Oklahoma, watching it on HBO.
At that fight, I'm telling you, you seen these thousands of people. I mean, I've seen Ali, I've seen Soul Train guy, I've seen Isaac Hayes, I've seen everybody at this fight.
And unfortunately, he lost a 15 rounder to Mike Weaver. But at that fight, Tillis was polished.
Tillis, of course, handled by Angelo Dundee, who has done a fairly good job with Sugar Ray Leonard.
Well, Tillis has done the right thing, utilizing that left jab, staying out of harm's way, because Weaver packs a punch in both hands.
Almost comes to a right hand lead, a little bit short. So Tillis up on his bicycle, but also doing a little bit of scoring here in round one.
You know, they really don't consider Tillis a knockout puncher. You know, that's in the same thing earlier. But he looks so big, he looks so awesome. I think he'll be able to change people's minds.
There's a right hand that gets into the face of Tillis by the champion, Mike Weaver. First round, WBA Heavyweight Championship, scheduled for 15. Neither fighter thinks it'll go that far.
Tillis has a good sharp snapping punches, whereas that Weaver punches are more solid, they land and they stick.
Crowd is really alive in this fight. They consider this to be the main event, not the Hagler-Hamshaw fight. Larry and Ray and I talking between fights about the fact that that was just an outstanding fight, terrific fight. This one would have to go some. To be as good as the middleweight championship fight earlier this evening. Coming up on the 22nd mark, remaining in round one here. Tillis scoring with a pretty good jab right now, but nobody really doing any damage. This is sort of the obligatory feel each other out round.
I have to say that I was very surprised and impressed by Tillis. He maintained his composure. I thought he won the round. Weaver tried to come out and intimidate him a little bit. He stuck that jab out there and held him off. And we may have a fight.
It was an experience to see him fight the Weaver fight, come out and dominate the fight the first 10 rounds. Then he started fading in the last part of the fight. But I know in a 15-round fight, James can attest to this, that you can beat the champion for 10 rounds. And if the champion come on strong in the last 5 rounds of the fight, some kind of way, the scoring system would allow the champion to retain his belt.
We know it's a lot of politics in that. We just always have believed that he was the true winner. But, you know, they gave it to Mike Williams. Just to see my brother in that ring made a lot of difference. It just meant that he was doing his best. And it was just good to see him there.
And really, to me, he won the fight. Of course, I'm prejudiced, I'm biased, or whatever you call it, but I was at the fight. And he whooped that man every round, but since Weaver was the champion, and he didn't knock him out, I think that's the reason why they gave him that fight.
But he gave Mike Weaver a good fight, and I know that he won that fight for Mike Weaver. He won that fight.
I was one of the proudest guys from Tulsa to see my homeboy up there fighting, and he did a hell of a job.
Angelo Dundee set it off. 3 minutes, 3 minutes. That is what's left for Quick Tillis. Whistling right hand misses. Not really seem to do too much damage. Weaver continues to be on the offense a little bit himself here. He almost had Tillis a couple of times in the last two rounds. Once again, as Ray Leonard mentioned, it's almost the fact of who's going to score with the first big punch. Either man will fall.
Well, I think Tillis needs this round more so than Weaver, because Weaver's the champion.
Tillis gets a punch in on the chin, but Weaver ties him up immediately. Tillis goes to the body, Weaver to the head, misses the long left hand. Weaver getting the better of that exchange. Crowd is on its feet here. Tillis is a tired fighter. Right hand does get in on the head of Mike Weaver. And now Tillis backs up again, lunges with a left hand that misses. Both men are tired. Right hand by Weaver, scores on Tillis, and the left hand backs him up. Halfway through the final round. Crowd is appreciating it. Dundee is yelling at his man. There seems to be little that Quick Tillis can do about it right now. Weaver content to tie Tillis up.
Moves away, he backs away, he doesn't follow up.
And Weaver bangs for the body, once more draws a warning for low blows. Tillis is hurt right now, can hardly breathe. The punches to the body really did a job. He is tired and he is hurt. And I think right now he'd like to just finish it. Get it over with. 35 seconds remain. Left hand to the side of the head. He is groggy.
Something's wrong with Tillis. Years later, you come to find out he was eating some of the wrong food, pork. I don't think he can drink too much milk. Something was disagreeing with his system. Because Tillis had that fight won, but he got tired. Certain foods he just cannot eat, certain drinks he cannot drink. It cuts off his wind, his breathing. That's why a lot of times during the fight, Tillis would hit Weaver with so many combination jabs, Weaver was about to go down. But Tillis was so fatigued, he couldn't finish him off.
He found out that he had allergies, and that's what was hurting him. He found out there were certain foods that he ate that caused his breathing to be disturbed. So once he learned more about taking care of his body and clearing those allergies, you know, his energy level was a lot better.
I think Tillis would have waited and let Jerry Cooney fight Mike Weaver. By that time, Tillis might have found out what was causing this, his breathing problem. Then he'd have won that fight with Weaver 15, or whoever the winner would have been. I think he would have been champion of the world in heavyweight division at that time.
He was just joking around. He's talking about The Color Purple, how he made the movie, really enjoyed it. And talking about how he and Oprah had a great time. And when she sat on his lap, she was a little heavy.
They called him the Black Gable, you know, because he was named after Clark Gable, which was a white movie star. They named him Black Gable because he had that charisma.
It was really exciting because I was in high school then when he came from Chicago. He had got us all a
Color Purple Sway Show, and he took us to the movie, and it was really exciting to me because, you know, him being my uncle and everybody, you know, was excited about that. I mean, we still look at that movie today.
I know you don't believe it, but I used to live here. This used to be my very own living room, and over yonder used to be where my kitchen was. Now, Harpo done rung the doors and windows from across the creek to here. Now, somewhere is my dining room. Lord, look at who's here. It's Miss Seeley. Miss Seeley, it sure is good to see you.
Here, pull up a chair and have a cold drink.
I believe I want me some of this here. I want to introduce y'all to my friend, Henry Broadnax is his name. Everybody call him Buster. He a good friend of the family.
Hey, how you doing? How you feel? Where your children?
They at home. Where y'all? Lord have mercy.
Hey, Uncle.
What you doing here?
I come here to hear Miss Suge sing and to see what a nice place you built.
Just a scandalous. Woman with chilling in a juke junk at night.
Oh, woman need to have a little fun, Harper.
Woman need to be at home.
Hey, I don't fight my woman's battle. My job is to love her and take her where she want to go.
Ain't that right, baby?
That sure is, Buster. That's right, honey. You got it.
Yeah.
Let's dance.
First time I ever been knocked down without throwing a punch.
You children are so clean. Would you like to work for me? Be my maid?
Hell no.
What did you say?
Hell no.
What did she say?
Hey, can't you pump that crude a little faster?
Quick had found my name in the phone book under writers. Okay, I'll meet with you. And I said, how will I know you? He said, oh, you'll see me. I'm the big cowboy. So I walked into the restaurant. And sure enough, people around him signing, wanting his autograph. This big guy stands up, this big belt buckle and his cowboy hat. And he hands me this scribbling stuff that was written on a big chief tablet. He said this was his story and he'd written it in jail, and I was immediately interested. Started reading through it. It was pretty raw, but I said, this is good. This is really a good story, and it was all true. It was not difficult to find a publisher because they knew his name. We had about three offers. The one that we decided to go with said, Jan, I need you to get inside his head. And that means you're going to have to write like he sounds. And I send this copy to my publisher, and I'm describing Ernie Shavers and his bald head, and I'm describing it as this beautiful black orb. And Quick Tillis is reading this. He says, beautiful, Jan, it's beautiful. And he says, what's an orb? I said, okay. And my publisher says, Jan, that's not how he talked. I loved the 2 years that Quick and I spent together. I would interview him, and we'd usually meet at a McDonald's about twice a week or so, and I just let him talk. We began to watch some of his films, Mike Tyson film, which was amazing, and I just have him sit down and describe, you know, everything that was. He has an amazing memory. So every detail, everything that was going on in his head. And I remember having to get down, you know, what a jab was. What's a jab? And I'd ask my husband, and I'd have to talk to Quick and have him demonstrate, show me the footwork he used. Learning about the Shavers fight, I got to meet Ernie Shavers, and we talked about that fight. And just going to the library is what I had to do, and read other fights. Some of the things that stand out for me is just the endurance that it took and the not ever giving up, the amazing mental game it is. And I began to have an amazing admiration for the game and realize that Wow.
Mama always knew that Junior was going to be someone great, because she instilled in not only him, but she instilled in all of us to be the best that we could be. She wanted him to go far in his dreams. Of course, she missed him when he first went to Chicago, but she was there for him, and she got to go to a lot of his fights more than we did. She was very proud of him, and she knew that she prayed many prayers for Junior to accomplish much in life, and I believe our prayers are still heard.
Quick has a praying mother, you know, and behind her being such a godly woman and a godly person and everything, those prayers, you know, when you send prayers up, blessings come down, and he's been blessed.
My mother was a true believer. She was a very, very Christian lady. She brought us up to go to church. No matter where we are, we went to church. She had us all dressed. James was, he loved church. Wherever he would go, out of state or wherever he was, he would always find a church to go to, because we were raised in church. My mother was a minister. She loved the Lord. She prayed for many of the sick. She would even pray for him when he got in the ring and lay her hands upon him. Oh, she was a mighty woman of God. She loved the Lord.
When I began to write about her, I was in my office all by myself, and I swear she was right there with me, and I felt her and his mother, and I felt her just like a presence over my shoulder saying, "You're doing good," because I didn't feel like I could do her justice. She's such an amazing woman, and so it was just a real privilege to get to write about her, and it was an honor for me. And we entitled that chapter My Hero, and so I think that was the climax of the whole book, because that's she really believed in him and was his best role model.
Yeah, I helped him get ready for the Mike Tyson fight, which was a fight that, you know, everybody counted him out on, and he was actually coming back to redeem himself, which he done a tremendous job in that fight. If you ever saw it, you know that the fight was held in Glens Falls, New York, which is Tyson's backyard, so we knew Quick wasn't gonna win the decision, but had it been held in Tulsa, Oklahoma, you know, James Quick Tellis could easily have won it. I spent about 60 rounds with him, helping him prepare for that, you know, and he mainly brought me in to help him with the speed. I was pretty fast and had good head movement, and that's what he was looking for. Tyson had good head movement at the time, he had good hand speed. And he was short, of course, like me, so James wanted to get the feel of what it was like facing a guy that was quick and had good hand speed and good head movement.
Everyone expected Tyson to just kind of walk through this, because I don't think he had been past something like three rounds. Tyson's back feet would come off the ground and his arms would just be like this, and the other guy would go down. Well, this fight started and Tyson would throw himself at Tillis, and instead of beating on Tillis's head, he'd find Tillis's glove in his face and be going somewhere else. He kept swinging in air. And this guy looked like Ali, you know? I mean, he was beautiful. He was doing the floating and the stinging and everything.
...of a draw. Three knockdown rule is in effect. No standing eight count. The mandatory eight count is in effect. Tyson in the black trunks and James Quick Tillis in the white. Customarily, Mike Tyson does not feel his opponents out in round one. He tries to take them out.
He tried to take Quick Tillis out with that first punch he threw, and Tillis showed why he may be a little bit different. He moved right out of the way of it, and Mike missed by quite a bit. The key to the fight will be Tyson cutting off the ring and pinning Tillis in corners and on the ropes like he did right there. Quick Tillis is 7 pounds lighter than when he fought Terrell Biggs. That would indicate, the look of him would indicate he's in much better condition. I think the postponement allowed him to get in better condition, will allow him to move more. The question is, how long can he move? His record is he's dangerous early, Jim. Can hurt you with either hand early in a fight, but has always faded and tired badly.
See Tillis delivering the left jab and following with the right. He is not running away from Tyson, and Tyson goes to work on the body. Some say that what sets Tyson apart is the intensity and the effect of his attack to the body.
It is amazing to see such a young fighter understand so well the importance of body punching. Generally, it takes a veteran to understand that by punching to the body, you can take all that movement away from James Tillis, and that's what Mike Tyson plans to do.
You saw Tyson with the left hook splitting Tillis's guard and getting the punch through moments ago as he had Tillis on the court. Joe Cortez, the referee, the only one of the three judges in Las Vegas a few weeks ago who scored the Larry Holmes-Michael Spinks fight in favor of Holmes.
That was an excellent right uppercut by Quick Tillis, which is a punch that should be effective against someone who comes in burrowing in like Tyson does. For some reason, Tillis landed. He was so shocked he grabbed. Tillis cannot, in my opinion, win a decision in this fight, Jim. He has to try to take Tyson out while he's fresh.
You see that Tillis grabs Tyson behind the head when he ties a fighter up. He customarily does it by tying them up behind the head. That will not deter Tyson from flailing away at the body, as he did right there.
And Joe Cortez, the referee, quite properly did not break the fighters because Tyson's hands were not tied up. Again, the right uppercut just missed that time by Tillis.
Late in round one, a round in which Tillis has not acquitted himself too badly, as he has managed to stay away from Tyson's thunderbolt, although he just took a right hand. We'll be back.
It was just a magnificent fight, and I was really surprised by the whole thing, because everyone, okay, so he goes five rounds. Well, he's going to go down pretty quick, you know? No, he never went down. And it just looked an awful lot like Tyson didn't win that fight.
Well, I think he should have won the fight simply because I just thought that point-wise, he did enough to win based on point systems. I think he scored the more cleaner blows. I thought Tyson was confused in the fight the whole time. I noticed that what he was accustomed to doing when he used to get inside is moving his hands in full rotation. He was unable to do that to Quick. Quick, you know, was able to catch him with counter shots. And also, you know, Quick was able to keep him at bay. So I think in hand, I just don't feel like Tyson actually did enough to win a decision. But I knew Quick couldn't beat him in New York on the decision.
Even though they gave it to Mike, it was a lot closer fight than what they said, and I really think that Tillis came out on top on that fight there.
First time in a professional career, which began 13 months ago, Mike Tyson enters round seven, another heavyweight. Tyson with the lead in the fight to this point over James Quick Tillis, but fighting a curiously docile fight so far. Not nearly as busy or as aggressive as we've seen him in his 19 previous outings, which resulted in 19 knockouts.
He almost looks right here like he's waiting for Tillis to make the fight, to come to him.
In case you've just joined us, it is Tillis, the fighting cowboy from Tulsa, Oklahoma, in the white trunks, Tyson in the black. Tyson co-managed by Jim Jacobs and Bill Caton. Tillis co-managed by Bo Williford and Gary Bentley.
One curious thing that we learned before the fight about Tillis' condition, we said he's always tired late. Bo Williford and Gary Bentley found out after the Biggs fight, through the doctor's examination, that James Tillis has a number of allergies. Among them, allergic to milk, citrus, and wheat, which could make things difficult for a fighter who, on the day of a fight, eats wheat cakes, drinks milk, and orange juice.
There you go, come on, there you go, James.
We have to assume that was not his pre-fight meal today.
actually was eating mainly cranberry juice. But it has helped his stamina. And I think he also trained harder for this fight. He realizes this fight means everything to him.
He has lost four of his last five. And Bo Williford told me last night that if Tillis were to be knocked out today and wanted to continue as a fighter, he would do so without the help of Bo Williford.
Yeah, this is career time for James Quick Tillis.
Incidentally, if you're not a boxing fan and Tillis looks familiar to him, you may have seen him in the movie The Color Purple, where he had a brief part as Henry Buster Broadnax in the juke joint scenes. He spent 2.5 weeks with Steven Spielberg and crew in Los Angeles, where they called him Dark Gable. Here's a right hand by Tyson. In the uppercut.
Tillis is not noticeably hurt by that punch.
But he's cut. There is blood above his left eye.
Exactly right. Mike was a little bit extended with the punch, did not have the proper range for full power.
Now he's at the right range. He lands something here. This is where he can be effective. Again, not punching at the body when Tillis grabs him behind the head. Tillis landed a left. Didn't seem to faze Tyson at all. We will stay here between rounds, as it is Tillis who tries to flurry at the end of round.
Of course, up and coming boxers like that, the ones with the names, if it's not a knockout, it's like the champ, you know, if it's not a knockout or something that's extremely decisive, then the champ or the one with the name wins.
He went 10 rounds with Tyson, and nobody else before him hung with Tyson 10 rounds without a knockout. That meant something.
Quick Tillis did beat Mike Tyson, and how he admitted that in his ear. You beat me, you beat me.
We are back in Glens Falls, New York, round 10. The crowd tries to liven itself up, try to provide some encouragement to Mike Tyson. Most of them have come here today hoping to see a knockout, and frankly, expecting to see a knockout. Tyson tries to deliver with the right hand and steps in and throws the left. Tillis again ties him up.
James Tillis is still a dangerous fighter. This is the most power and zip he's had in his punches at this late stage in a fight that I can ever remember. Tyson knows it, and I just don't think he's going to take any unnecessary chances. You can be sure he wants to keep the knockout string alive. But he also is just not going to take any unnecessary chances. He wants to win a decision, win a fight. He'll be 20-0, still undefeated, and in his mind, I think, still well on his way to a heavyweight championship.
But Tillis have revived his career somewhat, even with a loss, if he stands up.
Well, this certainly is a respectable showing, and there certainly will be notoriety to the man who broke Mike Tyson's knockout string, especially if Mike resumes the knockout string after this fight. To know why a crowd is booing. You can't psychoanalyze 8,000 people. I think it's possible that they're disappointed in Mike's performance. They came here wanting to see him do what he's done in his previous 19 fights, and he doesn't appear at this point to be going all out to satisfy them.
Landed the left hand, but Tillis stood right there. Cut is no longer a problem. It has been effectively stopped. Tillis comes straight in. Tyson, one of the few times we've ever seen him swinging wildly. Good left hand. Tillis is still there.
First,
a little of Tyson's own medicine. It'll be interesting to see how Mike reacts to this. Closing with a flurry. The bell is going to sound. Big smile on the...
What is so unique about Quick Tillis? There are a lot of fighters out there, but how many fighters, professional fighters, do you know who are truly cowboys? I mean, I'm talking authentic here, not just some get-up to for an angle, you know. But that's who he really is.
As a cowboy, he also set the image that a man can be, have a business mind, and be balanced. He was balanced because he was able to be a boxer in limelight. He was able to be just be himself and be a black cowboy. What he is at heart is a cowboy.
He got that from my grandpa Peter Hawkins. He was a real live cowboy. He rode a horse to the stove in the 60s. We used to go down the country every summer and see our grandpa, and he used to give us a baked sweet potatoes. And he used to have horses that he used to plow with and everything. And Quick used to run out there and get on the horses. Quick used to even drink the well water. He wanted to be a real cowboy. And he used the outdoor toilet instead of the indoor toilet.
It's the first time I met him. You know, he's got the big Stetson on and the belt buckle, and he's for real. And I mean, it's like he really today is living in the late 1800s. He walks slow. He drives slow. He gets up early, you know, at the crack of dawn, like the cowboys did. He's always wearing his bandana, has to have a nice bandana, and has his rag in the back to wipe his forehead.
I remember roping the calves in the front yard and roping us in the front yard.
When he started roping cows, when he actually got into boxing and wanted money and all that, getting money, he bought him a big trailer, and he would try to rope us with the rope that he would rope on the cows.
He'd be on his mother's porch, my grandma's porch, and he would say, okay, y'all go run. And he got his lasso, he got his rope, and he makes a real big rope, and he catches us. I mean, it literally surrounds us, and you know, all of us, 10 of us there, and then he drags us in the dirt to the porch.
Of course, he's a farrier, shoes horses, which is almost, you know, a career that's becoming non-existent.
We had some Shetland ponies that was called Rocky and Blue, and Quick was 6'2", trying to ride a 4-foot horse. Foot was dragging the ground. And I mean, that was comedy. That could have been on the most funniest video.
I remember getting on this horse, and the horse flipped me around. He got a little upset about that, talking about I didn't know what I was doing.
I mean, his mother used to get mad at him because he'd bring the horses downstairs inside the basement. And then when he come in, he always got cow manure on his shoes, you know.
One day I'm coming home, shooting by in my car, and I'm going, isn't that Quick Tillis riding a horse? And here he is in our suburban neighborhood, riding this horse and just waving and not in any hurry.
Right here, ride him on the street. Ride him with the cars. Yeah, he ride him with the cars, have a good time.
Here comes Quick with his horse, and the horse pees in my front yard, and all the kids come scrambling out of their houses. Mommy, mommy, a cowboy, a horse. And he lets them pet it, and they want his autograph. That's really who Quick Tillis is both a cowboy and a fighter.
Till's experience, you know, in boxing, you know, being a boxer, on his toes and all of that and everything. And that's the thing that seemed me as always taking him and moved right on up, you know, and all. Not just a slugger, a fighter, you know, a fighter, but a boxer.
I think Quick Tillis is one of the the most beautiful fighters I've ever seen. I mean, just as much like Ali as you could expect imagine anyone could be.
One of the best fights I've ever seen in his pro career when he was a guy named Nicky for the ESPN World Championship. For ESPN, ESPN was just getting ready off the ground, and Quick was one of the reasons why ESPN got off the ground. He was always the main event. Man, he brought the show, the boxing tour, ESPN. He was a phenomenal character for them with his style and his grace. And at that time, we was looking for another Ali, and Quick was the man.
I remember upcoming fights he had and at the convention centers, and I remember going to some of those fights and seeing him fight, and seeing him fight on TV was real exciting to me.
I had the pleasure of watching his last fight, and even though he was, late 40s as far as age is concerned, he wasn't as fast as he used to be, he still had those skills. And especially when early in the fight, when he was fresh, he was fighting a pretty young guy, a very skilled boxer.
He was all bruised and messed up, and it was like scene out of Rocky. And people were crowding around, and he was asking for me. Jan Price, where's my writer? She's my writer. She wrote my book. Jan!
We were able to be in the locker room with Quick after that fight. And as we were kind of standing around, he was sitting down, kind of, the guy that just beat him came into Quick's locker room and came and stood there, looked at him in the eye and said, "Sir, it has been a privilege for me to be in the ring with you. I thank you so much for giving me the honor of fighting you, of boxing." And it was just, he was just honoring Quick. But this is showing the honor that is between the ones who actually do the boxing. You could see that with Foreman and Ali and all of these guys, all of the different ones who really honor each other within the boxing. No one knows really what they've gone through except the boxers themselves. They're in a really elite club, and I honor them for that, really pushing their physical and mental limits to the very edge, sometimes not making it all the way, sometimes coming out victorious.
He got some managers that always did him wrong, and they'd set up the fights and they'd tell him, "You're going to get X amount for this match," and he would be ready, to get that fee, and then they needed to give money to so and so, and he wouldn't end up with much at all.
He see things, but he just let them pass because his focus was always on trying to get prepared and keeping his mind ready to fight. And you have to have that kind of focus when you're in the fight business in order to be successful and to go out and take care of your business.
They did not prepare him well, and they just took advantage. And it was always about trying to make a buck. He was buying someone a house, buying someone a car, and he didn't know what to do with millions of dollars. And he hadn't made it big like that before. Before he knew it, the money was gone.
You just have to have a sharp eye. That's why I say it's good to always have someone around you that you can trust. Take someone with you when you go to the pro game, someone that you know you can trust that would have your best interest in hand.
This is Quick Tillis' dream, to actually have a book. And the publisher decides, hey, we're going to throw a big book signing party. He's all decked out in his tuxedo. First thing we see is about six police officers. And the officer says, "Sir, are you Quick Tillis?" He says, "Yes, I am." He says, "Well, I'm really sorry, but we're here to arrest you." He said, "Yeah, one of your ex-wives says that you owe her for child support, and we've got to take you away. I'm really sorry." As long as he will go ahead and go through the program. We'll wait backstage with the handcuffs. So we're going on with the show, and he gave a great speech, and I gave a speech, and we signed hundreds of books that night, and then we walked off, and they were there with the handcuffs. And before we left, his sisters were all around, and they said, "We're going to pray."
We all look for love. Sometimes we look for it in people that really don't mean us any good. There were some relationships that weren't as healthy as they should have been for him. I'm glad he got out of them. But the good thing is he does have beautiful children that came from some of those relationships.
This was the way it went with Quick Tillis as far as the world of women. He didn't have the drugs. He didn't even smoke cigarettes. Didn't drink. But the one thing was the women, because they were always flinging themselves at him. He had, I think, 5 marriages, 2 with the same woman. He would get behind in his child support, and they would not let him go for that, and were always chasing him. So it was always, you know, not having enough money to be able to pay. And he needed to be responsible, and he knew that. And he would pay a little bit each month, but it was never enough.
I think he's a good father. He loves his children. He's not able to see all of them, but I do believe that they do know each other and they can come together when they want to. I believe in time he'll be able to not only spread his love around to them and his compassion, but he will be able to spread even financial things for them. So I believe that he's a good father in that sense.
I got to meet 2 of his wives. They seemed okay with him, you know. They were proud of what he'd done with himself. You know, they were still friends. What amazed me is you would think with a fighter that there would be physical abuse. Well, yeah, there was, but it was the women beating up on Tillis. I sat in the living room of one of his wives, and she would hit him with a skillet, and he would just not even fight back, because that's who Quick Tillis is. He's got a gentle heart, even though he's this tough fighter, but he wouldn't lift a hand against a woman.
Some of the residents in Tulsa, they somewhat laugh at Tillis, because they saying Tillis made all that money. What did he do with it? See, those are the people who don't know the boxing world with the money. A lot of things has to be paid, and you have to be about your business. I think Tillis trusted too many people. He trusted people to take care of his financial business, his financial house. He gave them all the leeway to do anything they want, just take care of him. Tillis didn't have a chance to put money away, I don't think. I think illicitly, people took money from Tillis. Tillis has a good heart. Good heart. For some reason, Tillis been married, I think, 6 times. And a lot of his money went towards paying for child support or spouse support or whatever.
Sport-wise, Quick Tillis is the first one in the 70s to put Tulsa, Oklahoma map around the world. Not just in the United States, but around the world. And you ask about Tulsa, Oklahoma, the name Quick Tillis come up. Quick was up there with the greatest.
Tillis, in my views, is not being respected by some of the fans that cheered him on when he was on top. Now he's trying to make a comeback in a different way other than boxing. That some of the critics, the boxing critics here in Tulsa, they laugh at him sometimes because they feel he's punch drunk. My response to those type of accusation is, can you walk in Mr. Tillis' shoes?
Well, there's a statement that Jesus actually made about the prophet having no honor in his own country or in his own town. I think Quick is a good example of that.
Tulsa, Oklahoma, I think we should rally behind him and make sure he's secure physically, mentally, financially, because he put us on the map. You see what I'm saying? Fighters right today, you can't mention a fighter without mentioning Quick Tillis in this area. If they come here looking for fighters, they got to go through Quick Tillis. They got to ask, where's Quick Tillis at? Because he's really an icon.
If he had won, you know, officially the Tyson fight, anyone who watches that fight, I think, will say, no, he definitely came out on top on points. He came out on top. He was the boxer. Tyson was
assassin, you know. But if he had officially won that, or if he had officially won a title fight at some point, maybe people would look at him a little bit differently in Tulsa. But he only, you know, he just came this close.
To me, he's still the greatest. In this area, there'll never be a fighter like him. We still haven't reduplicated him. Hasn't been another fighter fight for the world championship, as I know of, in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And I think we as fans of the fight game should say, okay, we got an icon among us, and we should support that and make sure he's safe, make sure he's straight, make sure he still glorified Tulsa. He does. I was glad to be able to witness what I seen and to see him sitting amongst all of them and everybody praising him. So we as Tulsans, we should praise him also.
What I would like to see is the boxing community just acknowledge who this guy is.
I feel strongly that Tulsa, Oklahoma owe Tulsa something. They should create something in his honor. From the mayor of Tulsa, Oklahoma, to just a regular citizen, Tillis is a legend in boxing. But Tillis has so many positive things going for him, from interviewing sessions with ESPN, you know, Wide World of Sports. This man experienced so much. And for right now, he have not too much of nothing.
My Uncle Junior, he was and is my hero, because when I didn't have my father, he was not in my life, you know, consistently enough. He taught me that tough side of a man.
He was always there with us, you know, as his nieces and nephews. He was always there to, you know, take up the slack with us. You know, if I was a guy, I'd probably want to be just like him, because I see him condition himself, you know, sacrificing a whole lot of things, just being there for his family the best that he could. See, he had ambition, he had dreams, he had, you know, I look up to him as, you know, a strong person, being in places that a lot of us haven't been.
He promised me a bike. He went for months, had a fight, came back, and out of all the nephews and uncles he's got, he brought me my first 10-speed. It was blue, black seat, and it was tight. And I didn't cry outwardly, but I was crying inside, because he kept his promise. And that's why he's my hero.
He's not just a person that wants to become famous because he's so well known. Junior just famous for being himself.
We had neighbors that have food, and I remember him going to the stores and packing groceries to the neighbors, to the children that didn't have food and stuff.
The love that he has for people is the fact that God lives in his heart, because he will profess Christ anywhere.
The news may not portray, you know, somebody right, but I'm telling you, I know him, that he's a good man, he's a good father.
And just to see him get out there and believe in himself and believe that he can make it was inspiration to me.
I was so proud behind the fact, hey, this is your brother's out the hood, you understand? And he truly represented. You know, he's a great inspiration to not only us, but to the neighborhood and the community itself.
You know, a lot of kids don't know, they didn't know who James Tillis was. They knew who Mike Tyson was. And whenever you mention Mike Tyson, you can't help from mentioning James Tillis. You know, he's the first man to go the distance with Mike Tyson. So there's your connection with the kids. And then they start looking them up on YouTube and on the internet, and they find out what kind of history he had, working out with Muhammad Ali, fighting for a title. You know, he fought big names, Vander Holyfield, Larry Holmes, Ernie Schaefer's. And then the kids, you know, now they know who he is, and then whenever they see him, I mean, he's made several visits into our small community, and you know, they look up to him. Whenever he comes in, they listen to him. So he's a big inspiration. You know, whenever he says something, then kids take it to heart, and they'll remember it for the rest of their lives.
You know, he has certain dreams. One of the dreams that I know that Quick has talked about quite a bit is simply to have a ranch.
And a ranch foundation for Tillis, I feel it's warranted. But I feel strongly that Tillis can help some of our troubled youth in the education system here in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
I would love to see the community get behind him in establishing a youth ranch in Tulsa, because in the first place, he has all of these skills as far as working with horses, the cowhand skills. He is a true cowboy. That takes hard work, it takes discipline. You put that together with the physical kind of training it takes to be a boxer. If those things could be combined in some way on that youth ranch, that would be an opportunity for kids to find maybe boxing, maybe some other sport, maybe working with horses, maybe working with cattle, the skills involved in that, to actually give them hope.
Tillis will always take time out for the youth. And Tillis will come and give the young guys some pointers on how to do this, how to feint, how to jab, how to hook to the body, hook to the head, the uppercuts.
Quick talk to them about life. Here were these kids that were in really tough situations. Many are impoverished, broken homes, people, including parents, telling them that they're not worth much. Quick was telling them, I don't care what anyone tells you. You got to believe in your heart, and look what happened to me. He said, I went to your school, and, you know, no one really believed in me but my mother, and I believed in God, and I believed in myself, and I made it. I made it all the way to the top.
It'll be a good thing for him to have children of all ages to come to a youth ranch to be helped. Children need an outlet nowadays. They need a place where they know they can belong. And I believe that if people see that this is a positive thing, that they would help to contribute to that situation. So that is my goal, to see him accomplish those things for young children and put positive things into their spirits.
They all wanted the autographs and, you know, wanted pictures with him. And so it gave them a real life hero. Someone that had actually come from their neighborhood and been to their and gone to their school and made it big.
The plan is to start a foundation for Mr. Tillis, and call it the Quick Tillis Foundation, where he can go out and help local boxing clubs, and then also pass on his legacy to the children, so you know, boxers like him and Mr. Tillis isn't forgotten.
When people come to Tulsa, we can also say there's Oral Roberts, there's TU, there's Ford Center, there's Quick Tillis' place. That's where he raised kids to help him with the fight game. He should have a ranch, rent a boxing ring. He should have an arena with his name on it. We cannot overlook our heroes.